Alright, so OpenFlow is currently the hot topics in networking. Very hot topic. And so we'll talk about six different things. Planes of networking. Then we'll talk about OpenFlow. How does it operate? Who implements them? How it has evolved? And what are its limitations? Oftentimes when people talk about OpenFlow, they talk about SDN and NFV. I'm not going to talk about them in this module. They will be talked about in later modules. So this is plain OpenFlow. So first of all, there are four planes in networking. And you have to understand this very clearly. Okay? Data plane. Data plane is everything that the user does. That involves user packets, user bytes. Alright? That means forwarding, fragmentation reassembly, and replication for multicasting. Those would be user plane functions, data plane functions. Okay? Control plane. All the activities that are necessary to perform data plane activities, but do not involve end user data packets. So before you can send the packets from here to there, user's packet, you have to have a routing table filled in. So how do you, so that is control plane. Now the question is necessary. Yes, this is necessary. If you didn't have counter, the routing table filled in, your router will not work. Right? So anything that is necessary, and I have underlined necessary part here, because in the next slide we are going to see something that are optional. I like to involve user data packets. Making routing tables, sending packet handling policies, security policies, base station beacons announcing the availability of services, all of those are control plane functions. These are necessary. Okay? Third plane is the management plane. Management plane is all the activities of monitoring, provisioning. So they look like control, but they are optional. To set up a computer, to set up a network, to set up a router, to bring it up, turn the power on. All of that is management. And that includes standards that you have to have five kinds of management. Fault management, configuration management, accounting management, performance management, and security management, FCAPS. FCAPS is the ISO name for all these five different managements. ISO is the International Standards Organization. When you instantiate a new device or a protocol, turn the device on or off, that is management. But all of this is optional, because in your home you don't do any of this. In your home you have a network running, but it is small enough that you can go and turn it on, you don't have to have remote control over it. Right? So that is management. The difference between management and control is management is optional. And it's just to keep things, you know, I mean, basically to monitor what's going on. So I tell this, when you're running a company, you don't really need managers. All you need is people who are really working hard. But sometimes people don't work hard. Sometimes people do get sick. So we need somebody to really look after all those things. And that is management. All right? And control is something that without which the company cannot run. Okay, so that would be like a transportation, buses, cars, whatever else is required. But management, managers are optional. And they are required only because the world does not work the way we want it to work. Now, services plane. The third, fourth plane is services plane. Which is that even if everything is running fine, even if all the tables are filled in, you may want to optimize things. By doing some things which help you optimize either the performance or the security or something like that. So all the things that we talked about, load balancers, proxy services, intrusion detection, firewalls, SSL offloaders, all of those things will go into a plane we will call services plane. Now these are again optional because in your home you run the network without any of these offloaders. Generally you do have a firewall. But that is big, I mean, you could have a firewall in the router, or you could have in the computer, or you could have none, you know, so on and so forth. So basically all of these things are just to provide things that you feel is the right place to enforce, whatever that is, okay? So four planes. Data plane, control plane, management plane, and services plane. Is it clear to you the four differentiators for them? Now, there is no, I don't think anywhere I have seen this four kind of definitions, so please make sure that you understand all this, okay? I have put a reference there, but I don't think they talk about these four, but anyway. So, when you implement a router or a switch, you have to put two logics. One is the data logic, one is the control logic. The data plane is implemented in the data logic, the control plane is implemented in the control logic. Right? The data plane has to be very fast, because if you have 100 gigabit per second, you want the data planes to run at 100 gigabit per second. But the control plane doesn't have to run that fast. You don't have to fill up the table at 100 gigabit per second. You could fill up the table in the morning and then forget it. Alright, so you could do it once a day, you know. So, control plane is slow and it requires a lot of brains. It's a lot of computation. Alright, data plane is very simple and fast. You look at the destination address and here you go. Alright, so there is a big difference between these two. The data, this is generally a CPU. The control logic is generally a CPU. Data logic is generally a specialized hardware. So basically this is called the fast path and this is called the slow path. Now some data does go through the slow path. For example, if you have a cheap router, it may not do multicasting in the fast path. It may just, when somebody has to be multicasted, it might send it to CPU and CPU will figure out what to do with it. So data plane goes through, you know, both fast path and slow path, but control is generally a slow path and data is generally the fast path. So OpenFlow, the key idea was that the control does not have to be in every computer, in every device. And they wanted to separate the control plane from the data plane, put into a central place, control into a central place, and then third idea was flow-based control, okay? Now, I'm going to explain this in more detail. So first, let me go through the history of this thing. The whole thing is started by this guy, Martin Casado, who is the founder of Nicera, and we have talked about so many times. He sold his company for $1.26 billion. He was a Stanford student. So he came up with this idea for security. So right now, the way we do security is we put the firewall at the edges. So when somebody comes into our network, we check them out. But once they are inside our network, we don't check them, right? It's like if somebody came into your home, we check at the door, but if somebody somehow bypassed the door, we have no checks inside the company. Right? So his idea was, why don't we centralize the security so that we check it at every router, every place, but from a central place. Okay? And so that was called SANE. S-A-N-E, security, and I forget the rest of it. But anyway, and then next year it occurred to him that why SANE, you know, we could do it for all the policies. If we can do it for security, we can do it for all policies, so he called it ETHANE. Now ETHANE generalizes this so that we want to enforce our policies and we want to enforce, you know, basically using a central place rather than doing at the edges, which was the standard practice at that time and which is actually even now. So in 2008, the first paper, OpenFlow, appeared in ACM. In 2009, the first specs were published. In 2009 also, Martin Casado found his company. Along with that, other people at Stanford found the company. So Martin Casado found Nicera. Guido found Big Switch Networks. And suddenly this became very popular. Now, it's not suddenly, I mean, these guys did a good job actually, I must say, in making it so that the whole industry was interested, and they had the first open networking summit in October 2011. I went there to that meeting. It was $1,800 for me to pay, I think, something like that, very high price. I went to that meeting and there were 1800 people there. You know, it was really big that every company was there. And that basically was, you know, clearly visible that now this is going to just take off. OpenFlow is going to take off. At that meeting, Juniper and Cisco announced the plans to incorporate OpenFlow in their products. In July 2012, VMware bought Nicira for $1.26 billion. And today, this morning, November 6, 2013, Cisco bought Insignia for $838 million. Their own SDN. So this is SDN startup. All right, today morning. I was just checking as to when Cisco did what, and I found out today morning, 59 minutes ago, they said, oh, they just bought the company. So this is going on. This is basically, you know, I mean, hot thing. Somewhere in this lecture, I will tell you other startups in this area, but this is what people are working on if networking. If they are in Silicon Valley, they are working on SDN. Okay? All right. Having said this, now having motivated you that you should listen, let's just listen to this thing about they did. So they said control and data. They said data can be everywhere, data plane can be everywhere, and that has to be fast. But the control can be centralized because it doesn't have to be that fast. We can put it into a central place, and then so we can fill in the routing table from there, and these people just use the routing table. So basically there is a controller and there is a switch, which can be called forwarding element because all it has is a forwarding element. And then the switch, any controller can tell by a secure channel so that nobody else can fool it, that this is our policy, this is how you send the traffic to this place and that place. So the flow table is nothing but the routing table. Okay? This is the invention. This is the idea that can get you $1 billion. Okay? Now, so control logic is moved to the controller. Switches only have forwarding elements. One expensive controller with a lot of cheap switches. And the OpenFlow is the protocol. So now, where is the OpenFlow? OpenFlow is the protocol that is spoken between the controller and the... So this is the OpenFlow protocol. So the controller tells this, the route, tells the switch, please insert this entry into your table, entry, you know, row number 15. That is OpenFlow protocol. So here is version 1. Version 1 is on packet arrival. So this is the flow table, by the way. And flow table has three fields, header field, counters, and actions. Header field is this long. So you match these fields, you match the ingress port. Now here's the thing, the port has two different meanings. There is a layer 4 port, which is the TCP port, and there is an ingress port. This is the interface, this is the wire, this is the cable, this is the NIC that you came from. So what interface did you come from? What was the source Ethernet address? What was the Ethernet destination address? What is the VLAN ID, which is the VLAN priority? What is the IP source, destination, IP protocol type, IP type of service, and so on and so forth. Okay? Up to this much. You match all this. If it matches, whichever line it matches, you stop right there. You do some counting. So they will specify what counters to increment those counters, and then do some actions. They will tell you what actions to do on that packet. So here is the example of flow table. Most of these are wildcards, except that what we have said is that if you see a packet coming, going to 0A:C8, then send it out on port 1 and increment the counter number 102. If you see a packet going to destination 192.168, send it out on port 2 and increment the counter 202. If you see a packet which has the TCP port 21, drop it. If you see a packet which is 806, which is an ARP protocol, ARP, send it to your CPU, locally CPU, and increment the counter 444. If you see a packet which is an ICMP, protocol type 1, ICMP, send it to me, controller. So basically, the switches nowadays, the question was, how can a layer 2 switch look at layer 4 headers? So all that is gone now. I mean, we already heard how you can send L2 over L3 and L3 over L2. and all of that stuff. So similarly, any switch can look at anything. Okay? So today we have L7 switches. L7 means layer 7 switches. What they do is they look everything from layer 2 to 7, everything, and then they decide what to do with this packet. So same way here, the open flow switches are basically layer 4 switches. They look at all the fields that are listed here. So the matching is done as follows. First, when you get the packet, you can right away note down what is the port it came on, what is the source address, what is the destination address, what is the Ethernet type, and set all other fields to zero. Because these fields are not next to each other, by the way, in the packet. So you cannot just go and take them. You have to go and search for them in the packet. But these first three fields you can get very fast. Okay? Source, destination, and the type. And the fourth is the ingress port. Set all other fields to zero. Then you look at the ether type. If the ether type is 8100, which means VLAN, then you note down the VLAN ID, note down the VLAN priority, note down the ether type in the VLAN tag, and use that ether type now. So previously you had ether type here, but now you will not use that one anymore because there's a VLAN tag, and that is the ether type you will use. Now if that ether type says if this is an IP, or whatever it is, then use that one, right? So you come back here and use that ether type. Now, is ether type 00806, and I just mentioned to you, 806 is the ARP. So, if 806 is ARP, then you note down what is the IP source, IP destination within the ARP. Now, you see, you have to go inside the ARP message. This is layer 7, if you want to call it, you know, whatever that is. So, within the ARP, you find out the source, IP destination, IP protocol type, IP type of service, etc., etc., and then you go out, get out. If it is not, then you look at the Ethernet type, ether type. If it is 800, which is IP, then you note down the IP source, destination, and so on and so forth. It is a fragment? No. It is a fragment? Yes. Whatever. I mean, not a fragment. Sorry, not a fragment? Yes. If it is not a fragment, then you type, write down the protocol type. Is it 6 or 7? 6 is TCP, 7 is UDP. If it is one of those, then you write down the port numbers. If it is not TCP UDP, is it ICMP? Protocol type 1 is ICMP. If it is ICMP, then note down the ICMP type and ICMP code, and then you go down, and then now you look up these fields. Now you know the fields. So far we haven't matched anything. All we have done is looked up, and now we know which fields to pick up from the packet. Right? Now we'll go and look into that table that we had before. In this table, match everything. If it matches, then we take the action and we take the counter. Counters are followed. These are all the counters basically. For every table, you have to count how many active entries, how many packet lookups were done, how many matches were found. For every flow, we have to count what is the flow. So by the way, if you match a table entry, that is a flow. Right? The next packet also matches the same entry, that's a part of the same flow. Third, fourth, fifth, something else may come through other flows and then so on and so forth. But if you don't see a packet for a long time, then the flow is gone and done, ended. Okay? So every entry has a timeout value. After that, the flow is gone. But up until that time, you keep the flow entry and that is the flow. So let's see where were we. So for each flow, we manage how many packets were there, how many bytes were there, how long did it go in seconds or nanoseconds. For each port, now here, this is confusing, very confusing, but this is interface port, not the TCP port. Okay, per interface. We should call it per interface. I'm just using the open flow terminology here, but it should be per interface. Per interface, you count how many packets they received and blah, 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 dropped and so on and so forth. And for each queue, what is a queue? So on each interface, we might have more than one queue because you might have high priority packets, low priority packets, wipe packets, this and that. So you have queues. So for each queue, you count how many packets to send, how many bytes you sent, and how many packets didn't make it. Overrun errors. Alright, so there are lots of counters, but should be clear now. What do you do actions? Actions are, forward to physical port I. Physical port I. Again, I think unless indicated otherwise, port here means interface. Okay. So, forward to the line number or link number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever that is, right? So, that is what it means. Physical link. But, sometimes it's a virtual link, virtual port. And these are the 6 virtual ports. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 virtual ports. If the virtual port is all, that means send it to every interface that you have, every possible way, except where it came from. This would be a broadcast. If it is controller, that means send it to who? To the controller on that secure channel. If it is a local, that means send it to your own CPU and let the CPU handle it. Table, perform actions in the flow table. And input, send back to the input port. Normal, forward using legacy Ethernet, traditional Ethernet. So whatever the additional Ethernet you would have done, which means looked at the source destination address and the VLAN field, use that knowledge. Flood is similar to all. Send along minimum spanning tree. So this one is all, right? Here it is along the minimum spanning tree, except the incoming interface. So with spanning tree, some interfaces might be blocked. So you just have to send to only places where it is, which is the minimum spanning tree direction. So this is for flooding. Anyway, so you can see all these actions. And then the other action could be in queue, which is put that into a queue number, whatever queue number is specified. Or it could be a drop the packet, or it could be to modify the field, easy, modify, remove the VLAN tag, or add the VLAN tag, or change the task bit, or change the TTL. So all of these are actions that can be programmed into that table.
Actions part of the table will be modified only by the control.
Controller, yeah.
By the forwarding.
Yeah, the forwarding plane here is dumb. The intelligence is in the controller. Good idea. This is a thin client, yeah. Never thought that way, but this is what it is. Alright, more about the actions. Masking allows matching only selected fields. You saw those stars, those are really the masks, which says they don't care. Right? If header matches an entry, corresponding actions are performed and the counters are updated. If there is no match, the packet is queued and the header is sent to the controller. Header is sent to the controller, which sends a new rule. Subsequent packet of the flow are handled by this rule. So it is quite possible that you might get a combination that you never thought you will get. Now you just send it to the controller. Controller will tell you a new rule, new entry, and then you follow that rule. Secure channel between the controller and the switch. We already talked about that. Modern switches already implement these flow tables, so they generally use what they call TCAMs. So TCAMs are basically content addressable memory. So TCAMs allow you to really match very fast. You give them the content and then they will say, okay, this matches with entry number 13. It's a good question. The question is, if you have a centralized architecture, how does it scale? The answer is, we will discuss that later on. All you need is, you need a lot more controllers than, you know, I mean one, and they allow that. And you need the controllers to be redundant so that if one fails, the other can survive, and then and so on and so forth. Controller can change the forwarding rule if a client moves. So for example, we could be saying, oh, all the packets for, remember that destination address, MAC address goes to this direction. But suppose that person moves over here, the controller knows that somehow, and then it says, okay, all the packets for that address will be going here. So it can change the entries. Then controller can, so mobile clients are handled by the controller, right? Controller can send flow table entries beforehand, proactive, or send on demand, reactive. And OpenFlow allows both models. So when are the entries filled in? You know, when you just come on, you turn on the power on the switch, they talk to the controller talks to the switch, and the whole table is filled in. And then before a VM is created, the controller would know that a VM is going to be created and its MAC address is going to be such and such, IP address is going to be such and such, it is going to belong to this VLAN. It could fill in the table even before. Right? That is called proactive. Or we could start the VM, and then the first packet comes to the vSwitch, and vSwitch says, sorry, I don't know how to handle this one. And then it will go to the controller, and controller will fill it in. And that is called reactive. So both models are allowed.